Thank you so much for coming tonight. I think we have a sold-out house, so we really appreciate your participation. My name is Melissa Marino, and I'm the chair of the MIT Enterprise Forum for the Central Coast chapter. And I just learned tonight, I've been chair for about a year and a half and part of this organization for about 3 years, and I just learned that it's our 30th anniversary. Wow. So we're really excited about this particular program marking our 30th anniversary. I think it's apropos. I'd like to recognize our board. I always do this every program because we are a volunteer board. And these programs don't come off without a lot of work and a lot of volunteer time. So I'd like to have all of our board members stand up and be recognized by our participants tonight. Thank you so much. In addition, we have several sponsors here this evening, so I'm going to just kind of run through the list, but if you're on this list, please stand up. We have Bank of the West, CIO Solutions, Cressa, Fast Spring, Nasiff Hicks & Harris, Pacific Coast Business Times, Riviera Insurance, and if I missed any of our premier sponsors, please shout out, but let's please recognize our sponsors. So before I introduce Bob Johnson, who is the moderator for tonight's event, I want to remind you about October's event. So we have events every third Wednesday of the month, and our next event is addressing technology of disaster relief. So that will be exciting on Wednesday, October 21st. So we're going to look forward to seeing everybody again next month. And I'd like to introduce Bob Johnson, who is a fellow board member, and he's our longest standing board member as far as I know, and been part of the organization for 16 years. And he's become just a personal friend of mine, and he puts on some of our best programming. And so I want to introduce Bob to moderate the rest of the evening. So thank you again, Bob.
Thanks, Melissa. I was told to talk loud, so I'm going to try. So how did this program come to be? Well, about 9 years ago, John MacFarlane came and presented the story of Sonos. It was only at that point about four years old. And some of you actually were, we have lists, some of you were actually here for that presentation. So it seemed like it was time to do it again. And so I went to John and said, you know, an update, it would be interesting, et cetera. And he agreed to do it, but he said, I think there's something that would be a lot more interesting, and that's to talk about what's happening in the industry more broadly, particularly the things that are happening now and what that's going to mean. And I said, that's great, but I wouldn't have no idea who to go find to do this. And he had ideas, and here they are. So many thanks to John for assembling this amazing group. It was not easy. Marc came from Germany just yesterday. A lot of people have, you know, moved around to get here and be here. I'd also like to make a little bit of a call out to Tom Conrad. He was here 6 years ago. he had to come at the last minute because Tim Westergren, the CEO of Pandora, couldn't make it, and so Tom came down and he had no idea what he was supposed to do, and he gave a great talk. It was one of those things where he just told us what was going on, and some of you were here for that too, and there are a few people who were here for both, so it's a long history, but that's the kind of stuff we like to do, to keep following what's going on technologically influenced industries. And a major thanks to Marc for fitting us into his schedule. As I said, he came from Germany just Monday night to be here. And I think you'll find his presentation tonight to be something that you will remember. Before we begin, I would like to introduce two special guests. two honored folk who live here in Santa Barbara and have been in the music business for a long, long time, and in fact, come to some of our previous sessions. They're both still active. The first is Bud Carr. Bud, where are you? There he is. Bud has had a long career producing films and supervising music in films, independently and with several major film studios. He's still very active. He's currently working with Oliver Stone on his latest film, Snowden, which is about, of course, Edward Snowden. On a personal note, one of Bud's favorite achievements is that his son has this thing called a car winery, which is just a few blocks from here. And it has occurred to me that we need a wine sponsor, and they may very well be the people to go to. The other guest is Cliff Magnus. And I don't know where you may be sitting. Ah, okay, there's Cliff. Cliff is a Grammy-winning songwriter, a nominee, Academy Award in the category of songwriters, producers, and multi-instrumentalist. He's also still very active, working with a number of up-and-coming singers and songwriters. So, nice to have them here, and they may have some questions. They have seen a lot of the history of the music business. So to our program. On August 12th, NPR had a little story about Columbia House. Some of you may remember it was sort of the Book of the Month Club of records. Every month you'd get records from Columbia House. At its peak, its revenue was $1.7 billion a year. Last year it did $17 million, and this year it's bankrupt. I think it's a reasonable stand-in for the kind of changes that have occurred. They were, if you remember, doing vinyl. I don't know if you can get to the first slide. Let's see how this works. This is a quick look, and these are not necessarily comparable, but the red thing is what's happened in terms of digital delivery of music. It's all been pretty recent. This is what's happened to revenue over the same time frame, the last, basically the decade that ended in 2009. And this gives you an indication of units, if you will, of music, and how the purple thing toward the right is the digital part, and what's happened to the revenue to the industry. Obviously, there's been a lot of pain, and the digital part doesn't seem to be generating a whole lot of revenue. So that's what this is all about. And in this world of streaming, the questions are who's gaining and who's not, or who will be. I think we mostly agree that consumers are getting a deal. The record labels, they probably are. It's harder for us to know that. These guys know this sort of stuff. The artists are definitely not getting as good a deal. The digital distributors, plus minus, there was an article, or I guess a thing by the Motley Fool a couple days ago about how Pandora and Spotify can never make money no matter how big they get. And then ultimately there's the audio makers like Sonos. At the end of the day, you have to be able to hear the stuff. And in general, they've probably done a little better. And if you throw in automotive, there's some real opportunity there too. So I'm going to introduce Marc Geiger to talk. We're kind of following the electrons. Marc is involved with the artists and the creative processes. Then we will have Tom from Pandora involved with delivering the electrons. And finally, Sonos involved with making it so you can hear them. And after they've each talked a bit, then we'll kind of have a roundtable discussion. I imagine they'll keep each other busy, but if not, we can throw in some extra questions, and then we'll definitely be sure to have some time at the end for Q&A from the audience. So if you can we'll bring up Mike, and if you can get the Prezi thing working.
Hi, I'm Marc Geiger. I run the music part. Your office reminders me when to shut up. So I run one of the biggest talent agencies in the world for music. I'm the global head of music, but I'm actually a recovering .com CEO, which is why they invited me. I took my old company, Artist Direct, public the day the market crashed in 2000. And ever since then, I've been pre that and after that, while I'm in the content businesses now, I'm fascinated with the reconstruction of our business and ultimately all the media businesses. Before I start, I wrote a little presentation because I love to do these things. It's in, I tried to get copywritten approval from Lord of the Rings, but it has Lord of the Rings metaphors, so it's not totally dry and boring. But a couple things to note. One, the Motley Fool has the word fool in it. They're not really right about Pandora and Spotify, but I understand why they say that. We'll talk about why, so a little bit about why they're not right and what scale means, and how these companies will be making money unless they just mess up and they don't get the consumers. And two, they showed kind of those graphs about revenue dropping. That was, just so everybody's clear, that was a function of the suppliers not keeping pace with the market. Otherwise, consumption's up, all right? I think, just to give you an example, 2 weeks ago, they released a statistic that there were 1 trillion songs streamed in the first 6 months of this year. It's the most consumed anything other than communication on the entire internet, mobile, blah, blah. It's not even, nothing's even close. So 1 trillion tracks in 6 months. So when they talk about not being able to make money, it's just not being able to monetize it properly, but the consumption's already there, and that's quite unique. The other thing was I was at the Video Music Awards. They were terrible, but when Taylor Swift was accepting her award, she said something unique, and she said, hey, I just want to thank my fans for watching this video that won the award. You guys watched it 1 billion times. And if you grew up in any part of our business, those numbers never existed. A gold record was 1 million, platinum record was 1 million sold, and it was huge, right? Michael Jackson sold 20, 50 million records, whatever. So these are, we're in an unprecedented time of scale. But I'm going to take us back a little bit, not quite to Middle Earth, but before then. In the beginning, there were physical formats, and everybody was happy. And then the internet came, and the music hungry and unsatisfied said, I want my music on my computer, damn it. And so the crumbling of the industry began, and the war took all the money and all their property, except for live income. Digital music starvation then came about in about the mid-90s, when unsatisfied music fans wanted more music at much cheaper pricing through the net. To get their music, these music hungry had to fight through nasty file sizes, slow ripping with CD burners, expensive hard drive upgrades, terrible bandwidth, and death by stealing. Now, I met a couple 17, 18-year-olds here. They have no idea what I'm talking about, so it's kind of funny. I was thinking about it, I was going, what are they, they're not even gonna know what a CD burner is. Anyway, just, sorry. 56K modem, what? So, I grew up with a T1 line. Then came more plagues of digital rights management, Napster, MP3.com, peer-to-peer services, bad interfaces, larger file sizes, more slow bandwidth, high-priced files, label and publisher wars, lawsuits, major label consolidation, copyright infringement, incomplete libraries, and confusion, 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 just to get where we currently are in our story. Now, we all had to live through this, so remember, this is our business that we had to live through. It was real fun. Actually, it was kind of fun, if you like being disrupted. So, now we begin chapter 14 of the Great War of Digital Music, titled The Giants Save the Day. Orders are stored, and the world shuts up and watches. So the Motley Fool is wrong. Anyway, on the left are what I'd call the giants. And the giants are anybody with roughly 100 million customers to 1 billion customers. Kind of, those numbers are unprecedented. When we all grew up, Walmart was the biggest. Hard to compare to iTunes, 700 million credit cards, whatever. All of these companies are enormous, and they have enormous reach. One thing to note about them, and this is from a previous presentation, but I think it's worth bringing up. These are the biggest, most influential companies in the music industry today. 15 years ago, none of them existed, and the giants were a completely different set of companies. Bud knows this, okay? Completely different from Viacom and MTV and Tower Records and da-da. So the other thing to remember when we're talking about this is the entire industry and all the companies literally got decimated, wiped out. Imagine the whole city, every building's gone and replaced with all new companies. So within the things I just in the last two slides, that happened also, all right? And then in smaller roles, there's some of the companies on the right. We'll see what happens with all of them, but it's not really that important. Ultimately, they all have their own path and they're all gonna figure out what to do. As we enter this 21st year of the war, the storm clouds brew over the landscape as the giants trudge onto the field. They bring with them other services and armies of video, film, TV, video games, books, and more, i.e. Amazon Prime, Google Play, etc. Okay, so it's not just Spotify, Pandora, and more, creating further blended subscription offerings and hard-to-understand pricing. They also bring a host of other businesses which make this war seem quite petite. Apple Pay, Android Pay, operating systems, etc. And insignificant to these giants, while millions of music hungry stare at the music equivalents of Godzilla, King Kong, and Mothra, hoping they give a damn and make a good product. One thing's for certain, for both consumers and content suppliers, confusion runs amok. The battle's over who has true power to scale users, using their weaponry of 100 million to a billion plus audiences, internal payment systems, and blended billing. The giants hope to convert their loyal minions to pay fees for a variety of content services. You guys have to explain who King Kong and Mothra is to the kids as well. Here's a snapshot of what's still to be figured out. And part of why I say this is it's early. It's early still. I've been doing this 24 years in the digital business, and I tell people 2 years ago, they just came out of the locker room and onto the field. So it shows you sort of where we're at. Okay, content libraries are still evolving. Sometimes you go into Spotify, you request an artist that you love, and nothing's there. Pricing, we're still in the great freemium era because we don't believe that $10 a month for all the music in the world is a good deal, yet you all pay $180 for your cable, and you don't watch it, and you watch Netflix and Apple TV, and you pay additional because your cable sucks, and $10 is too much, so... And there's no new release tier, so Taylor Swift doesn't put her album in there, and there's no high res, and blah, blah, blah. So we're still in early days. Most of the services, Spotify just recently, I was busting their balls in a meeting because I went to new releases, and I would look down, there were 72 Mozart and Beethoven re-releases before you got to the new Drake album, and it wasn't really that great. Anyway, the metadata cleanup, it's still a disorganized mess. John and I have been talking about this for years because I'm a huge Sonos freak and a Sonos user, and Sonos pulls the data. And so they get the benefit of the corrupt data when you're using it. It was always wonderful. Interfaces and personalized recommendations are just really beginning. Even history files are new in this arena. I was just showing Tom that Apple Music doesn't have a history file, or you can't get to what you just played. So if you leave your house and you go to your car and you want to continue playing what you played, good luck finding it. It is doable, but hard. Human curation and point of view curation is just beginning. The first real music DJ has just gone online on Beats One. His name's Zane Lowe. It's changing the world already, but it just happened. I think it's 3 months old. Publishers are still fighting the labels for higher royalty. They're in Washington trying to restructure how they get paid in a digital environment. And the courts are going to decide on what copyright reform is, but obviously they're all very schooled in music copyright, not. So here's what why this slide sort of starts really where I think we are in history. You heard earlier, and it was a good setup, that Motley Fool said Spotify is never going to make money, all right? Or whatever they said. The bottom line is we're in a time when there's a lot of players. There's obviously the super mega Google, Alphabet, Apple giants and Amazons. And then there's sort of everybody else. And I believe that when you're not making money and you have to survive, you hook up with the dance. So I think a lot of mega mergers, what I call filling out platform mergers. Tom's old partner I got in lots of discussions with that I thought a user when they use Spotify, but they were a Pandora user, Pandora needed to offer a Spotify type on demand feature. So, you know, who adds services to their existing platforms? Who buys who? It doesn't make sense to me that Netflix has however many customers and loyalty they have and they can't offer you music, yet Google's gonna do that. What's Shazam going to do? So I think there's a lot of play in all of these companies, who they buy, who they merge with, what services they add. And so I think for the next 3 to 5 years, we're going to see a lot of that. That's one. Two, if you're not familiar with our business, one of the things that was very interesting about our business was how horrible both the financial money distribution was, because it was all kind of, I think it's this. And it wasn't digital with log files and proper accounting and everything like that. It's kind of famous for that. The movie business, the music business were legendary for accounting practices. And also, there are statistics. If you know, we grew up in television with an Arbitron system, and a Nielsen household system, an Arbitron system on radio that were based basically on estimates, extrapolation, things like that. We're still in a system that's transitioning. The TV business has been disrupted from the Nielsen, you know, once TiVo came out and all the time shifting and people were saying, oh, it's plus 4 days to see if they watched it and skipped through the commercials and what have you because they had to report to advertisers. Music business was even worse. few weeks ago, I was at home and I was showing a hit record video of record, or sorry, a video on YouTube to my girlfriend, and I said, "Oh yeah, this record came out. It was number two this week, sold 65,000 units, and the YouTube window said 585 million views." And she looked at me and said, "So you guys still count the 65,000?" So it shows you kind of where we're at. So the revenue, the same way Merrill Lynch, Lehman, everybody used to call buy stock from broker, and then one day you heard about Charles Schwab or eSchwab or E-Trade or Ameritrade, and it was $9.99 for a trade, and everything was on your desktop, and basically you had Bloomberg at your disposal. That's starting to happen in the music business, just starting. But basically everything that Pandora plays or Spotify plays or Apple Music, it's in a log file, it's digital, so you know exactly what it is. But somehow they haven't really wanted to build the systems that suck that information in and then give it back to everybody. But that's starting to happen. It's not the copyright holders that are doing it, it's third-party companies. So this e-tradization of money, and the, or I call the flattening of revenue, is another movement we'll see over the next 3 to 5 years. And then this is a interesting one. The businesses of what I'd say Silicon Valley and the content creators were very separate. Ironically, only in California, Northern and Southern California, it was very symbolic. And all the action was up north, and the money was up north, the investment, the innovation. But now that the smart pipes are built, so to speak, a lot of what's happening is the content can't just be the Wild West of YouTube, the content's starting to matter. So the content on Netflix matters, Apple TV matters, Spotify matters, all these platforms matter. And they have to be organized and they have to be programmed well. So the next thing that's happening is, or another movement, is that seasoned content professionals are going into these companies and they're actually doing well at them as opposed to being rejected like a bad body part. So that's the third big thing that's going to happen. Anyway, the big giants, the contenders, plus the telephone companies and other big billing giants are still kind of showing dumb and not sure what to do. And they're slow, and we're going into yet another period of unstable and evolving plans. It is not smooth sailing. And there's a lot of copycat in our business. I call it lemming-like behavior. All right, and that is happening all over the world. I just came back from Australia. They barely know what Spotify is. All right, few things for sure. Streaming has won. 1 trillion songs, 6 months. Vinyl, ironically, for those of you that still have your vinyl, is the preferred physical format, and it's working, and the value is going up. It was always going to be a coffee table physical victor. I don't know that the industry thought it would be vinyl, and it's mostly for romantics, but it works. As I said, $10 a month is still a fight, which is nuts to me, but whatever. The windowing and tiering I spoke about has not commenced. We're still in the great try it before you buy it era. No one understands blended offerings yet, not even the copyright holders and the content providers. I don't know. I asked every digitally savvy label, movie studio head, whatever, do you know how much you get paid in Amazon Prime or Google Play? And they couldn't, they have no clue. I said, if I pay $100 and I get all those things, is it based on, is it a flat rate for movies, video games, books, television, music, and it, the $100 is carved up, or is it based on usage? And they said, they don't know. And I thought, all right. So that leads me to the next point. The industry has no idea where the money is coming, going, nor do really the creators. However, a lot of the copyright holders did get equity for some of these players, and hopefully they'll make money. They're starting to get sued for it because they didn't share it with the artist, but that's okay. At least they're getting something to sort of bridge this revenue chasm they've all been through. As I said, the flattening of money or the e-tradization has begun. Like they did with iTunes, because they said iTunes was terrible and Apple was ruining the business until they sold about $6 billion worth of files, and then they thought iTunes is saving the business. They thought Spotify and Pandora were killing the business, not paying them until there's 100 million subscribers, and then they'll think they're saving the business. So that's going on right under our nose. Apple Music, which just had a what I think a really poor launch, with some exceptions, of Beats 1 and version 1.0, I think people thought it would save the world. I think people also forget anybody who's smart in technology, and I think everybody in this room knows, if you buy version one of something, it's a risk. You wait for version 1.2, version 2, versus the third version, whatever it is, and Apple 1.0 came out kind of meh, but we do have our first ever worldwide radio station. It's kind of fun to be all over the world and be able to listen to one thing that feels familiar. I still am mad at the BBC, who makes some of the best documentaries and programming in the world, but if I live here, I can't watch them on their iPlayer, even though they were the first, one of the first ones to do the internet quite well. The charts are all changing, consumption's all over the place and untracked, i.e. 65,000 sales and Nielsen ratings still matter. And okay, a trillion tracks stream, so everybody should calm down, it's gonna work, including the Motley Fool. In any case, next few years will be marked by rapid user growth, refinement of these offerings, personalized interfaces, expanding content libraries, confusion and complaining over the money, and lots of action. Thanks.
Well, that's a tough act to follow. I don't have a extended Lord of the Rings metaphor for you. So my name's Tom Conrad. I spent 10 years as the CTO and head of product and engineering and design at Pandora. They asked us, or at least my synthesis of what the ask was for this first 10 or 15 minutes from each of us was to talk a little bit about our experience of music over our lives. So I thought I would start at the beginning. The first record I ever bought was Sean Cassidy's eponymous debut in 1977. For those of you, I'm glad it's such a cool one. Anyways, I thought maybe you would remember the Do-Ron-Ron. Amazing, amazing track. You know, this is a thing that happens when you work in the music business. People ask you, like, what was the first record you ever bought? And it's always something cool, unless it's Sean Cassidy. He was on the Hardy Boys television show, which is pretty awesome. But then, you go, maybe you can, like, kind of segue into what was the first concert you ever went to. And I'm pretty sure it was Sha Na Na at the 1981 Ohio State Fair. So I'm just not winning on this dimension. I got a little bit better about the time I got to high school. So I was in high school when the CD player first was kind of coming into fashion. And so I bought my first CD player in 1988. The first CD I ever bought was Peter Gabriel's Security, I think, which is a much cooler, much cooler choice. And somewhere along the way, I was kind of that guy you knew in college who wanted to kind of sit you down in front of their stereo and say, oh, if you like The Cure, you've got to hear Susie and the Banshees, and if you like Susie and the Banshees, you've got to hear The Glove, and just kind of bore you to death until you tried to sneak away. So I went to college from 1988 to 1992, and just to kind of set this in people's memory, this is before the MP3 was invented, the first commercial encoder came out in 1994, this is way before Napster. I remember getting my paycheck from the computer lab that I worked in and taking off my books and my rent and stuff and figuring out okay, I've got $45 left. That's and measuring it and basically how many CDs I could buy with what was left over. So I was a big music nerd, very lean in kind of music fan when I came out of college. But the other thing that I was really passionate about was personal computers, and I really went to college. I mean, honestly, I went to college so I could work for Apple. It was my only goal, which meant I really paid no attention in physics class at all. So in 92, when I graduated, I got my dad's car and I drove to California and I got a job at Apple working on the Macintosh. I spent some time developing video games in the mid-90s, including a game called You Don't Know Jack that was a little bit popular for a while. And then I ran engineering at pets.com and nearly destroyed the US economy by myself. Along the way, the CD collection of mine kept getting bigger and bigger, and I never really sort of participated in the whole Napster early MP3 era. I mean, it always seemed like stealing to me. But I did eventually rip all of my CDs. You talked about it, people who can remember that. Well, it took me about 250 hours to rip all 1,000 of them. And that meant they ended up in iTunes, and I could put them on my iPod. I could stream them to my stereo with this little tiny kind of funky device called a squeeze box from a little company called Slim Devices. That was an early competitor to you guys. But I remember being just really frustrated, and this is about 2003 now. I'd done all this work. I'd spent all of this time putting my music into a computer, and it did almost nothing for me. It wouldn't tell me when new albums came out by my favorite bands. It wouldn't introduce me to other people who had similar music taste. It wouldn't make recommendations about other music that I might find interesting based on what it understood about me. It just seemed like this really, really, really stupid jukebox. And so I started thinking about kind of how I could take some of the things that I'd learned developing recommendation systems and consumer software and software for the internet and create applications that would make use of all that kind of technology in the context of music. And before I go on, I'm going to talk about Pandora a lot. I should remind everybody that I haven't worked there in 15 months. A lot of the team is brand new and really, really incredible. A great new CEO, a great new CTO, a great new head of product, a great head of strategy that just came in. So I'm going to talk about Pandora a lot, but it's a lot of my perspectives are pretty dated at this point. And certainly I want to make sure that they have all the room in the world to navigate the next 10 years. But in 2004, I met a guy named Tim Westergren who had created something called the Music Genome Project. And the idea behind this was to do a rigorous analysis of 100 years of popular music and to understand each and every song at the musicological level. So not just what kind of guitars are being played, but what does the composition for the guitar look like? How do all of the instrumentation come together? There's 40 different attributes that define just the vocal performance in a pop song. Now, unfortunately, at the time, and still today, we couldn't write software that would listen to the music automatically and extract these musicological properties. Back in this era, the state-of-the-art kind of machine listening software would be able to extract maybe 10 or 20 properties, and we were encoding hundreds of different properties about each and every song. So we did the unfundable, unscalable thing, which was we hired semi-unemployed professional musicians to come to the office every day and put headphones on and listen to every song that would ultimately be part of the recommendation engine of the Music Genome Project and analyze them across these hundreds of dimensions. So I came along in 2004, met Tim, and he'd been taking this technology and putting it to use, I mean, frankly, kind of in any context where someone would pay him money for it. So he had built kiosks for Borders and Best Buy. He had built a website for Tower Records. He'd built an API to plug into the music section of AOL.com. But he'd also, on the back of that success, raised some money from the venture community for the first time. And with that investment came the expectation that they'd bring in some consumer-focused people like myself. And Joe Kennedy was the CEO for a decade. And build a consumer product. This is a picture of a cactus that I drew the other day. I think I was a joke to make about this, but I'm not really sure what it was. I think I was going to say that this is really all I've accomplished in the last year. Maybe, I don't know. More significantly, the question, though, in 2004 when we had the Music Genome Project and nothing else was, what kind of consumer music offering do we want to be when we grow up? And candidly, kind of looking at my own music consumption, I was really excited about building something for a very lean-in music user. I still wanted to solve this problem of I've ripped all of these CDs and let's take all that data that we know about the people that have done that work or built MP3 collections on their own through theft and make additional music recommendations, introduce them to new music, other people that like the same kind of music, bands that are coming to town and so forth. And Joe Kennedy, the CEO though, made this observation that if you really want to impact the world of music at scale in the United States, it's really all about radio, which is a huge surprise to me. But still to this day, 80% of all music entertainment in the United States by hours consumed is radio. Just 20% is music that people own. Now, probably the kind of people who come out tonight, to participate in an evening like this, you're the exception, you're nothing like the rule. This probably seems like the biggest bunch of bullshit, but this hasn't changed for 100 years. This is what music consumption has looked like for time immemorial. Now it's like 70% terrestrial radio, 10% Pandora now, but it's still kind of this radio format where you don't have control over what plays, you give it a kind of a hint about what your musical taste is by maybe selecting a frequency on the FM dial or telling Pandora the name of an artist or song that you love, and the DJs behind the service, whether that's software or humans or some middle ground, which is probably what Clear Channel is, make the choices for you. 20% of music consumption is kind of the on-demand category, so that might be buying vinyl or CDs or subscribing to a subscription service like Spotify or Apple Music. And So when you look at it, like, why is that the case? Why, you know, do people get so much of their music entertainment from radio? The first thing is it's really easy. And, like, I have to say that, like, you know, while I love the experience of going into an Amoeba Records and being surrounded by, you know, thousands and thousands of pieces of vinyl or CDs or browsing around in Apple Music or Spotify to find the new release that I'm excited about, a lot of that experience for the everyday mainstream music consumer is incredibly intimidating. It makes them feel stupid because there's this vast world of music and they just don't know how to find what they're interested in. So radio solves that by being very simple. You press a button, some music comes out. It has this interesting characteristic where it's full of discovery. The playlists are kind of constantly evolving without you doing any work at all. But it's also very familiar. I mean, a lot of what works in radio is this idea that there's a certain kind of repetitive nature to the format. And of course, finally, it's ubiquitous. It's in every car, it's in every bedroom, it's in every kitchen. And that, you know, having the music just right at your disposal everywhere you go is incredibly important. But radio also has failings. Increasingly in the United States, the music stations that you get on the FM dial cater to a narrower and narrower musical range. There's nothing that personalizes the experience to your taste at all. If you hate that new song by whoever, The Weeknd or something, there's no way to escape it. That is a really great song, though. Why would you want to escape that? And there's a tremendous amount of advertising, you know, 20 plus minutes of advertising per hour. And as much as I love Zane Lowe, boy, does he talk a lot. So there's a lot of that as well. And, you know, if you enjoy the format of radio with a host, you really have to accept that you've got, you know, 20 minutes of advertising and another 15 minutes of them talking and a tiny bit left over to actually listen to music. So we thought that there was a kind of window there to reinvent radio, to embrace the things that were great about it, but to improve upon some of its weaknesses. So what happened? So we launched Pandora in the summer of 2005. It's actually almost exactly 10 years ago. The company celebrated its 10-year anniversary a week ago. In the first 3 years, we grew the service to 12 million listeners, 12 million registered listeners. It's not even active, that's just the people that had signed up to use the service. And I have to tell you, I thought this was an absolute home run. I thought I had died and gone to heaven. It surpassed my wildest dreams about what we might do with this little service. And then the iPhone came along. So in the summer of the summary of 2008, also the summer of 2008, the iPhone launched. This is the second generation iPhone, the one with the App Store. Pandora was very, very fortunate to have an app in the store on the first the day that it launched. And part of what made that possible was about 3 years before the launch of the iPhone, we began investing in building clients for mobile phones. I'm talking about like flip phones, like the Razr and the, you know, the little LG phones that we all carried before the iPhone came along. I have to tell you, that was tremendously difficult work. Not just difficult, but unrewarding from an adoption standpoint. I think we had Pandora running on 40 or 50 different feature phones across all the carriers for about 18 months before the iPhone launched. And I'm pretty certain that the statistic is that we had more listeners on the iPhone 3 hours after it debuted than we did on 18 months on the flip phones. But we laid a lot of the groundwork for being able to really build a high quality mobile experience on the iPhone by making those investments in those earlier platforms. So fast forward to today. About 80 million people tune into Pandora and listen every month. It's a service that's only available in the United States. So if we compare it to what that looks like against some of the other properties that you're familiar with, that's a larger audience than Twitter has in the United States. Listeners spend more time listening to Pandora than they spend watching YouTube videos in the US or on Facebook in the US. And of the top 10 mobile applications by audience, Pandora is the only one that's not made by Google or Facebook. It's almost 10% of all radio, take all terrestrial radio, satellite radio, and so forth, put it in one big pool, Pandora comes out to be one out of every 10 hours. Pandora is the largest radio station by audience size in every major market in the United States. Pandora, at this point, I think we can safely say, successfully competes with literally everyone, because every single company in digital music has built at least one, if not two or three Pandora clones. Apple, Google, Clear Channel, I mean, who am I forgetting? Everyone. Yahoo, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So, why did it work? Well, I think in part it worked because we were a very, very focused company. It wasn't that it was lost on us that there was a big opportunity to reinvent the kind of the record store by building something like Spotify, or now Apple Music, or Rhapsody for that matter. But we just thought it was a big separate problem, and we had our, you know, our hands full building something that would reinvent radio. We also focused on making the product incredibly easy to use. We focused relentlessly on personalization and making sure that the audio experience of Pandora was an exceptional one. I mean, I got beat up a lot as the guy who ran product for not adding features to Pandora. People would constantly come and say, you know, another year has gone by, Tom. Why aren't there four more buttons in the user interface that you can point to and say these were the four big features of, you know, 2009? And what that analysis of Pandora missed is that we were taking all of those resources and plowing them back into making the best playlists in the world. When we launched Pandora on the iPhone, this funny thing happened. People kept coming up to me and saying, I really love Pandora on the iPhone. It's incredible. The playlists are so much better than the playlists on the web. This is a curious thing to say because it's exactly the same servers delivering exactly the same playlists. And I was puzzled by it for a while. And I started to develop these theories like, oh, well, maybe like it's a kind of placebo thing because you have it in your pocket and you take it with you and it feels much more personal and you're just much more engaged in it. It can be part of your life away from the computer. And so, you know, all of this, these theories. And then I finally thought to ask one of these people this question: when was the last time you listened to Pandora on the web? And they said, oh, and you know, in 2005 when you launched. Aha, well, Pandora in 2005 versus Pandora in 2008 was not a fair match at all because the playlists were terrible in 2004, and they were getting okay in 2008, and we've made a lot of progress since then. We also invested a lot in ubiquity. So it's easy to focus on the success we had on the iPhone and then Android, but we had a huge audience on BlackBerry for the BlackBerry era. We're on over 100 distinct automobiles today. And thousands, literally thousands of consumer electronic devices, of which Sonos is, of course, our favorite. And by our, in that sense, I mean my wife and I's. and then I would say that it also worked because, like, I think the people who start digital music companies are like me. They're music nerds. They, you know, ripped all their CDs and want to sit around and talk about the first Nine Inch Nails concert they saw and, you know, how there were only seven people there and yada, yada, yada. They don't listen to the radio. So everybody, just their natural focus to like build the, you know, solve your own problem, build a product for yourself. Well, we didn't. We built something that's not for lean-in music fans. We built something for like Joe Average, the kind of regular music consumer in the United States. So it was an incredible run, exhilarating, exhausting, rewarding. But there are a lot of things that I worried about during my tenure there, and frankly still worry about today. And I'm just going to kind of tee this up, and maybe we can talk about some of them as we move forward with the discussion. But like, I worry a lot about the animus between artists and labels and songwriters and services like Pandora. I heard this funny thing the other day. There's a really exceptional guy named Daniel Glass, who has a record label called Glass Note Records, and Pandora finally, in the last two or three years, has been able to make big investments in building tools for artists to better understand their audience on Pandora, to plan tours, to communicate with their audience, to speak to them on the air, and so forth. It's a really exciting part of the evolution of the Pandora story. And Daniel's been a big proponent of this platform and has spoken out about what a great thing it is. And he was interviewed by CNBC the other day, and he was talking about all these things, saying many nice things. And he said, he's like, I really love how Pandora has changed in the last few years. It used to be that no one from Pandora came to any of our concerts, and now I'm constantly getting calls from the Pandora leadership. Can I come to this show? Can I come to that show? So the funny thing about that is we're this tiny little company in Oakland, not the biggest ego company in the world. And actually, we thought it was like really douchey to ask the record label guys for like invites to come backstage. So like, we were at the show, Daniel. We were just in the audience. So it's just, it's funny. Like there's these, so his perception of us was we were snobs. We weren't even showing up for his shows. Our perception was like, oh, we don't want to be the douchey guy who's like in this just so we can meet famous people. So lots to do to improve the relationship between these different parties. And I guess my sense, and maybe this may seem a little Pollyannish, but I actually think that in most instances, everybody has the same set of goals in mind. At least on the service side, my perception of it is truly not that the services are trying to, you know, find their success at the expense of these other entities. In fact, quite the opposite. Most of us got into the business because we wanted to help artists find their audiences. I worry a little bit about the high price of on-demand services. It is very clear that the on-demand streaming is going to win. Like, it is the future of the record store. We are not going to like download MP3 files to our, you know, iPhones and, you know, manage them on USB drives. But the trick is that the typical US consumer for time immemorial has spent $35 to $50 a year on music. While $10 a month, I completely agree with you, seems absolutely ludicrous that we can't get Americans to spend that much on music when they spend, you know, gobs more on that than things like cable television and coffee and so forth. The truth is there's just no precedent for them spending that amount of money. And so I really worry that as these services become the predominant form of music delivery, it's going to leave a lot of people out, right? You know, I think 20% of the US population last year spent $120 on music. So like, where did the other 80% go? Do they just get Pandora? That's not enough. You need access to on-demand music as well. And we as an industry need to figure out how that looks. I worry a little bit about this kind of siloing of content as we have these different kinds of music services. You know, Apple gets an exclusive with one artist, Tidal gets the new Prince record, Spotify gets their thing. As a music fan, you know, I think we want places where we can go, where we can have access to all the world's music, and to have to manage multiple subscriptions all at $10 or $15 a month seems particularly challenging. I think sort of a meta problem is that I think audiences in the United States don't value music generally sufficiently to compensate anywhere near all the talented aspirants that are out there. Just quickly do this math with me. So let's assume that the typical band has four members. You know, a drummer, a singer, a bass player, a guitar player. We want to pay all of them $50,000 a year, which is a pretty poor salary. So that means that band has to make $200,000 a year. And we're not going to give any of it to the managers. We're not going to give any to the labels. We're not going to spend any of it on anything for touring and so forth. We're just going to put it all in their pockets so they can live like school teachers. So now we're going to spend $1 billion on music in the year. That $1 billion pays 5,000 bands $50,000 a year each. So we're talking about an industry that, you know, at its peak was, for the recorded music, was $16 billion. Maybe the whole category now is, when you take live into account and so forth, is $30 or $40 billion. We're talking about enough money to only pay maybe 150,000 bands, 200,000 bands, this kind of school teacher salary. And that's if the labels and the managers and the venues get nothing. And just to put that, all those numbers in context, so a couple hundred thousand bands, there were 100 million bands on MySpace, 100 million. So there's just not enough money to compensate the talented aspirants. And so I think we can't, it's always going to feel like the artists are getting the short end if we don't find a way to put more, get consumers putting more money into the musical ecosystem to compensate all these incredibly talented people. And then finally, I think that there is a nuance in the conversation about curation, which is a big topic these days. We talk a lot about how Beats was curating playlists for their audiences, and now Apple Music is curating playlists for the audiences. Pandora is actually always curated. It's funny, I think our competitors like to talk about it as like the big robot in the sky, but like, you know, they only started doing that when it didn't work, to make fun of the fact we had professional musicians who came to the office every day and put headphones on and made selections of music and coded, did all this encoding work, and all of the genre stations on Pandora are hand curated to feed the initial algorithms. But what's what's different in Pandora's case, and many of these digital service cases, is they start with curation, and then they let the user give feedback about what they like and what they don't like. So it gets personalized to your taste. So you start with the best that the machine can do, combined with the best that a human can do, and then you let the end user ultimately decide, do I love this song or do I not? So that's kind of my view of how curation fits very positively into this world that we live in. There's another thing, which is taste making. That's I tell you that the new song by The Weeknd is cool, and that the song that you like by Miley Cyrus is not. There's room for lots of things in the world, but I'm not particularly excited about using the technology of the internet, which allows us to personalize completely to your taste to tell you what kind of music you're supposed to like. So anyways, so these are some things I worry about. Be fun to talk about, maybe. I'm going to turn it over now to John.
I just wanted to say, because they never would say it about themselves, Marc actually has the distinction of being the very first music entrepreneur in the dot-com sense. So I remember sitting with Ian Rogers, who was the CEO of Beats Music, and he started up the Beats One radio station that they were just talking about. And Ian told me in his first company, Marc let him sleep on his couch and rent some space. So Marc was number one. And then the first successful streaming music company, you are. I'm showing my age, I apologize. And Pandora was unquestionably the first scale streaming music company. I mean, if you look, you listen to the impressive stats, and you sitting in Sonos, you could see it happening, and I'll show you some usage data. Those guys were way early. The first name for their company was actually Savage Beast. And luckily, someone came up with Pandora, 2005, four? I remember them popping out. And I would never have let them curate a party of mine in 2005, but I think about 2008, 2009, I actually had a party and I let it go to see if anybody would notice, and it worked great. So it was a real turning point. And so, really interesting set of people here. And Tom did all the technical work behind Pandora, so you have a good set of people. I have a funny relationship with the two of them. I've known them for 10 years each, a little more. And most of it is them beating on me. So Marc would call me up, what the hell were you doing with this metadata and Sonos? And I wish you'd do this. And I asked you for this last year. And Tom would call up and say, you guys have to be able to take our app and send it to Sonos, and you're taking so long, it's just nuts. And then every once in a while I turn into a therapist, because if you're in digital music, at some point you have a crisis. And Tom will call me up and go, God, I'm so worried, what if Apple Music fails and it takes the whole industry down? Ah, Tom, it's okay, it's gonna work out. So. Anyways, the life inside of streaming music. Okay, I was just going to show a couple of graphs. I'm not going to talk about myself or Sonos very much. Because I think the more interesting part is I can say from the 12-year journey of Sonos to here, and then the 12 years ahead, it's a real defining, it's a pivot point. In Sonos, we would find people like Tom or Marc who had ripped their music, and then we'd explain that you could put it around the house, and then we'd introduce them to a streaming service, not these particular guys, but that's on average what we would do. And there's a complete revolution happening in that we're more and more able to talk about talk in context of the streaming services, and that just started happening this year. So it's a big change. You can see it on all sorts of the data. And you can see some of the challenges the industry has, because I think Bob showed a graph here, but this is 8-track, this is vinyl, this is cassettes, this is CDs, and of course that's, if you're talking to the label people, they always talk about that point. And then these are downloaded tracks, so everything green and left is purchased. You know, you you bought the Beatles, 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 all in different formats, right? And but once you bought it, you weren't going to buy another Beatles CD or whichever. What was your first album? Yeah, you didn't rebuy that in CD, did you?
Mine was Don't Shoot the Piano Player by Elton John.
Oh, awesome. That's a good
album.
Yeah. That one is streaming. Now, the funny part of it is it's subscription, okay? So it's not a one-time purchase. It reoccurs. And, you know, if you worked in the software industry, and I'm older, I think, than both of these guys. My first job was working at a store, and you put the software in a floppy disk, and you hung it in a plastic bag, and it hung on the wall. And that's what you bought. The software industry switched, I'm sure you all know, to subscription. You now pay monthly or something like that for all your software. You don't get to pay once for that version. And it's a better way, because you're, you know, if you're in the software business and you know your customers are paying you every month, it's more stable business. If you're a public company, you've got better visibility of the revenue, everything gets better. If you're in the music business, the miracle is pay per play. You know, when Sonos did its first integration with Rhapsody, Rhapsody paid about a penny a track per play. So each time you press play on any track and you picked a track, out went a penny to all the rights holders. Now, how the penny got divided up and everything is a whole interesting conversation. And by the way, that predates digital music. There's been fighting over that stuff from the beginning of time between the labels and the artists. But that's a really interesting model, and it's not comparable to these, because over time, a usage model versus a per-play model, you have to make some assumptions because they're apples and oranges. And the industry doesn't even know how to compare them yet. I literally took this out of, I think this came out of the RIAA stuff, but I was telling Tom Conrad earlier, when I talked to the Universal CEO, he couldn't even track the Pandora revenue. And Pandora is about $1 billion in revenue annually, and about $500 million goes to the sound exchange, which breaks it up among the labels. And the biggest slice of that $500 million goes to Universal. And Universal didn't even know how big that was, because when Sound Exchange would report it to Universal, they'd report it in a category called Other. And Other was getting bigger, but they had no idea what it was until I pointed it out. So, you know, the industry just going through a big change. I wouldn't entirely agree with Marc, and he and I have been aligned on this. There are more people listening to more music all over the earth than ever before, and he gave you that track number. And it's a creative process, and it's just how you connect those two is getting redefined. It's not through Tower Records, it's through Pandora and Spotify and Apple Music now. You know, the CD did an interesting thing. We've all heard about it. It really spiked the album sales, because, you know, that you've all run into and you've all heard about the three tracks on the 12-track CD that you didn't want. And of course, in digital music, that broke it up. So if you want to make an album in this modern day, it better be a good album, like when the Beatles made an album or when Quadrophenia came out, because you're going to have to get the fan to listen to the whole album. They're going to skip the tracks they don't like if they don't fit. I don't think there's anything unhealthy about that. One of the artists once told me, hey, if I really wanted them to listen to the whole thing, I'd make one track that was 35 minutes, and people don't do that. But they will. I'm sure some artists will. They still talk about track equivalents sold. So you see this, you know, there's lies, damn lies, and statistics. It's really true in this industry, because the industry doesn't know how to track the right things yet. The other thing is every country is different. So this is a whole set of different countries. It's a little out of focus. One is physical sales, and one is digital. And you can see it's just all over the map. It depends where you live. The bottom one is percentage using free or paid music streaming services or download services in the past month. The white is subscription. The brown here is downloads. And you can see it varies by each one of these is different countries. Not surprisingly, that's Sweden. Now, that's hometown for Spotify. About 20% of the population in Sweden uses a paid subscription service, 20% of the population. If you buy a Sonos in Sweden, you're 99.99% likely to put your Spotify or your Tidal account on it. So if you go and hang around in Sweden, this thing already happened and they're way ahead. Now, if you hang around in the US, because Pandora really took off, you don't even know what an on-demand service is, typically. So we're one of the furthest behind. So each country is coming from a different place, and that makes some of the complexity. Keep in mind, the traditional recording business thought about the US, the UK, and then everything else is international. So they don't know how to think about each country being different. And China's marching right along there in some very interesting ways. So huge transition from physical purchasing to streaming and on demand. Physical still dominates in a lot of countries. Austria, 65%, Germany, 70%, Japan, 80%. Now, a funny thing happens in Japan. One of the heads of the labels said to me, why is that the case? And I said, because you haven't licensed a single streaming service in all of the country, no surprise. And a funny thing happens. If you look at the demographics in Japan, the older population still buys CDs. The younger population goes to a CD rental store. And if you look at read-writable CDs, they know what it is because they're using them, and it's the largest market for read-writable CDs because they're ripping music and they're not paying. You know, same thing that happened here when Napster came out. So we don't learn our lessons very often, and that's a good example. You might read in the paper that Google Play Music launched in Japan. Now, what they don't say, if you look in the fine print, 4 million tracks. Now, Google Play Music in the US, if you get on there, 40 million tracks. Sony launched a streaming music service in Japan, couldn't get Sony Music on it, okay? So it's just kind of a confusing environment where this is going on. Here's a really interesting country I cut out, Finland. This is from 2014 and 2015. And the interesting thing is the total market stays about the same, 15 million euros. Now, the breakup in 1 year, green is subscription, and yellow is the physical. So look at the shift happening. And this isn't unique. You just have to dig into each market and see it happening. So it's all happening. It's just not easy to see it in aggregate level because you have all sorts of different outliers. You know, so what is, in the end, what's the behavior this whole industry is serving? It's serving music listening, and that's been going on for thousands and thousands of years. It'll be happening in thousands of years. It's a creative endeavor. It's hard to make great music. That's all healthy. But what's happening right now is all these music lovers are coming from different places on the planet. And so in the US, you have a mix of physical. Marc still has his ripped collection, probably. Nope, you've gotten rid of it. All right, you're one of the few. You might have some digital purchases. iTunes was most successful in the US. Now, what isn't known it's been declining years for now, and Apple was adding new countries, so the aggregate number was getting bigger, but as they watched the US, it was declining, and so they knew that they needed to move. But people have some tracks they've purchased, and what do you do with them? And here, when you look at Sweden, they were physical, and they went hardcore to piracy. This was the epicenter of piracy, and they were protected by law. So no recording, no label, no artist could go after the pirate bays and the BitTorrents and the stuff like that. And in fact, all the founders and people behind Spotify were behind those original services. So when you see the big fights between free and paid and Spotify, keep in mind they had to bring the entire youth audience that had gone free and were fully protected into paid. And They've done that. So 20 million people are paid on demand. 20% of the population of Sweden are paid on demand. So, you know, that's a big data point. China's going straight to streaming. If you went to China 10 years ago and you went on the corner in Beijing or Shanghai or wherever, you could buy any CD you wanted for a nickel. And of course it wasn't legit, but I think when I first met Lucian Grange as he came into Universal, the entirety of 4 billion euro revenue for Universal Music, 160 million was China all in, and it was all ringtones from one of the big telecom companies. And of course the telecom company was making $1 billion in revenue and paying them 160 million. But from Universal's viewpoint, that's better than nothing. But what's happening is the government, as it joined the World Trade Organization and really started having intellectual property, they're enforcing it. You see it in you see it in movies, and you see it in music. So you may hear about the search giant Baidu in China. It's Google's competitor in China. Baidu got its start as an MP3 search engine. That's what they did. They figured out where somebody had shared a track that was ripped and where you could go get it. No longer. So the government's really going after that. And China's unique because when the government decides no more pirated music, you go to jail if you do pirated music. So it disappears pretty quickly. So in China, a unique thing happened. You might hear the company Tencent, big internet company in China. They have a service called QQ Music. It's a really high quality, like Spotify or Apple Music competitor. They licensed exclusively all of the major labels. So they have Universal, Sony, EMI, Warner. They have everything, and they have it for 2 or 3 years while they clean up all the piracy and get the users to pay. So it's all happening all over the world. You know, in a few years, we'll all look like Sweden, or they'll look like us, however you want to look at it. But it's all coming along. Again, here's Sweden. So this was that same graph that was on the top right. 92% subscription, 5% downloads, and where's the US? Right here. We're exactly opposite that. Now, we're not gonna stay there. You'll see a lot of advertising around Apple Music in the fall. You'll see Spotify. You'll see a lot of activity around this. And you're gonna see that climb. I like to compare this to the internet days, and in about end of 1995, the internet had just about 50 million paid internet users in the entire world, 50 million. And in 95, to remind you, Netscape was the king of the crowd. Everybody talked about what Netscape was doing. The search giants were Yahoo and AltaVista, and Yahoo, by the way, was human-curated search, if you remember. Excite, InfoSeek, yeah. So Google didn't even exist. They were in grad school at the time. And it was a teeny place. So if you were in that 40, 50 million paid internet users, and it cost about $15 a month, you knew what this amazing thing of the internet was, and if you weren't in that group, you had no idea. People would say, is that like Minitel? Or, and of course, nowadays... nowadays, it's a ubiquity. It's almost a utility, the internet. And so music is about at that stage. There's about 40, 50 million paid on-demand music subscribers. And that number's growing really rapidly. So I think you'll see a lot of changes. I also think, and I've already seen it, I think these guys would both agree, the labels have changed dramatically. So the way it worked up until today was you, as an entrepreneur, would launch a service, and Pandora was a really interesting example because they lived under a unique US law. And only the US and Australia have that law, and that's why you don't see Pandora anywhere else. So if you leave the shores of the US and go to Europe, you can't play your Pandora. It's literally blocked. If you got up and running, you like a Groove Shark or a Napster or an MP3.com, and there's a wonderful picture, and I should have put it in here, of all the music startup companies. I have all their logos collected, all gone. And there's literally 100 different startup companies. There was an article written in 2007 called The Dead Zone, because that was the dead zone. If you tried to start a music internet company, you would soon be sued by the labels. Well, they're leaning into it now. So they're trying to figure out, how do we enable this stuff? How do we invest in? How do we have a part of it? And that's a big change. So I think you're going to see a tremendous amount of diversity in music companies. If any of you remember a company called Turntable FM, it was a great idea. It was these virtual rooms that you went in and Q-Tip could DJ, or Zane Lowe or Tom Conrad or whoever, and you could just hang out in the room. And if you didn't like the DJ, you could vote the DJ down, or you could go to a different room. Super good idea. You know, you could collect everybody on the planet. Of course, they just took off, and then the labels walked in and shut them down. And by the time that the label negotiations got underway, the users had all left, and it was dead. So you're going to see all these things come back, like happened in the dot-com burst. And I'm pretty optimistic about the whole thing. So you heard about Tom. And this is a really common theme. You see it all over the place, and I'll show you it in the data. There's really two fundamental listening behaviors. I called it lean back. I think Tom called it lean in. And then lean in. Lean back meaning, you know, on Pandora or traditional radio, you have some preferences. You pick K-Rock or whatever, and then you know what's going to come out. But you don't get to choose the next song. Lean in, you choose the next song, and that was the equivalent of Tower Records, or, you know, buying what you wanted and playing it, whether it was from iTunes or traditional. So I think you're going to largely see, in my personal opinion, those come back. Pandora's free. I'd like to see the labels license it globally, and I argue it's in their best interest to do that, and I continually remind them of that. But you know, they get half of Pandora's revenue. If you make that a global audience, that's a good thing. It's going to be a bigger and bigger and bigger pool. Advertisers like it. It's a successful model. Ditto, if you want to choose the song, you pay $10, 10 euros a month, 10 pounds, and you get to choose whatever you want out of all the music ever made at any time. Amazing thing. I can show you how consumption of music increases, and I'll show it on here. But, you know, there's some bumps in the road. Marc Geiger talked about the number of views on YouTube. The labels did a funny thing when YouTube came out. They watched it start taking off with music, and they said, yeah, we can have more of that than they take, and we'll launch this thing called Vivo. And when they started launching Vivo, the YouTube's not dumb, so they said, well, since you're doing that, we aren't going to pay you as much anymore. And so they rejiggered the economics of YouTube streaming and fundamentally made YouTube not work for anybody. Okay, now the labels thought that would be okay because they thought Vivo would take off. It didn't, and nothing replaced that revenue. They capped their revenue and nothing happened. Now the trick is, how do you solve that? You'll probably see YouTube streaming get turned off, is my guess, and they're starting to experiment with not the labels not putting the content up on YouTube and putting it on the on-demand. You saw Dre's album go on only the streaming services and started with Apple, but didn't go on YouTube, if I'm not mistaken, still not there. So, you know, there's still stuff to work through on how you work out ad or free-based and on-demand-based. You know, the U.S. and the Sweden are probably the two most interesting spots, and the reason I say that, the U.S. has this wonderful mix of library services. If you ever bought a CD on Amazon, they make it all available online for you on their service, so you don't have to rip it. Free streaming, and of course, Pandora is the absolute monster there, and it is a monster. If you looked at, when you install a Sonos system, we ask a user if we can anonymously collect your data, and about 60% of the people say yes. Across the US, over half the listening time on all the Sonos sets are Pandora. So it's crushing terrestrial radio, it's crushing everything else. The next 25% is all terrestrial radio and internet radio across the globe streaming, free streaming again, the last quarter is the on-demand. So it is the dominant way people listen to music. People love it. Funny enough, most musicians hate Pandora. It wasn't, as Tom said, it wasn't written for the deep music aficionados. I love Pandora, so I guess I'm in the wrong category. But only the US has that, only Australia too. So you can't see that in any other data. There's these weird cats, Sirius XM with their satellites and in your car. And the on-demand is just starting. In Sweden, it's all paid on-demand. And then what you watch is the free streaming is, of course, the radio stations you can stream over the internet. But there's no internet radio. And Beats One is the first one available in Sweden. And if you want to compete with Spotify, you're probably not going to get the Swedes to switch to your subscription service. You've got to do something that Spotify isn't doing in Sweden and get people on that. And so you can see that's why Apple is doing things like the Beats One service. So, you know, what's Apple's impact? One of the most positive things I watch is they got the labels to see that global streaming radio was important. They couldn't see that before. You know, they just couldn't even see Pandora, and they couldn't imagine letting them off the coast of the US. So that's happening. Google has a wonderful service they've made free, and they're working on global. So you're going to see a lot of activity on these fronts. You know, here's a roll-up of services. Just for example, Apple Music and Beats One, Spotify, Pandora, Google Radio, On Demand, and YouTube, SoundCloud. If you're a music aficionado, SoundCloud's a wonderful service. Deezer, that's a French on-demand service title. That's the one Jay-Z's gone after in Norway. Rapster, Napster, they were the first on-demand. Rapsody really was. RDO, both of those kind of ran out of stream. Amazon's kind of sitting out of this one. They've got an Amazon Prime Music service. If you're a Prime user, you get it, but they don't have universals. So that's 40% of all recorded music, about 50% of the most popular music. So it doesn't work real well. Slacker, Stitcher, these are radio services in the US. China has a huge diversity of different services. QQ Music is a lot like a Pandora. Alibaba, you've heard of, they have a music service, Kugu and Kuyu. Douban is the Pandora knockoff in China. The US has these weird pieces, Cumulus, iHeartRadio, and Sirius. There's really nothing like that outside of the US. It'll be real curious to see what Sirius does. 27 million paid users, and I think they typical $20 per month per family. That's two cars. Well, every car is getting internet connectivity, so are you going to sit with Sirius or are you going to use one of these? And that's going to be a big battle. They're going to have to do something. Europe. You have services that are associated with the retailers. MediaMark, which is Best Buy, has a service called Juke. Fnac, which is kind of like Best Buy for France, has Jukebox. So yeah, there's a lot of diversity here, and there's a lot of new ideas coming along. So it's pretty healthy, actually. All right, I told you we measure people's usage. This is hours in a week. So here's how they kind of roll out. You see the streaming services, Pandora, Songs, and geez, I forgot which one that one is. They're, you know, 14 hours a week. That's a lot of listening time, believe it or not. We had lots of debates inside of Sonos. Is that because people walk out of their house and don't turn it off? And so we put features in because Pandora would be paying for that if that happened. It's not true. People are listening. Might be at work. It might be... you know, in the kitchen, it might be background, but it's a lot of time. The US has this middle tier because you have Sirius XM, and it sits iHeartRadio. It sits in the 8 to 10 hours range. Then you have the on-demand services. They're about 6 hours. So that's Spotify, Google, Rhapsody. And then I call it specialty on-demand. If you look at a SoundCloud and there's a certain band you like, you'll follow them and they'll put their cut tracks or things up there. But they don't have the same library these guys have. They may launch services like that, but they sit down there and they have a huge attach rate. So if you like music, you're highly likely to be a SoundCloud user. And then the icon here is people do still have tracks on their mobile phone or whatever they stream, and we see those. It's typically around the holidays, funny enough. So we see, you know, you've got this Christmas track you love to play and you keep it on your phone and you play it a lot more. So that's what it looks like. That's all positive for those usage numbers are all positive. I would say if you take 200 million, and I don't think it's a huge stretch to find 200 million people across the globe at $10, euros, pounds per month, and you've got a more healthy music industry than ever before. Now, the challenge is for like a Universal, they just saw their revenues hit the lowest point. Now they're on the way up, so it's all on the way up. And I'd say if you want to watch the health of the industry, watch ASCAP or BMI. They're the people that collect the songwriter fees, and it's just a pretty clean metric. And they're doing better than they've ever done in the history of those companies, if I'm not mistaken. Both, I think, have gone over $1 billion in revenue, which is they've never done before. So, you know, it's in the right direction. So that's my presentation, and I think we have question and answer after that. So.
Well, that's a lot to absorb. I guess kind of a general question is to just say to you all, did any of you say anything that others of you disagree with? Because there was a lot of similarity, but I did think there were some things where there might be some divergence.
I think I'm probably the most optimistic on the number of subscriber number, paid on demand, maybe Marc. You and I are in that boat. Tom's much more skeptical.
I mean, I think 200 million is a really exciting number when you forget that there are another 7.8 billion people on the planet who want to get their music through this streaming format. Maybe not all 7.8 billion, but that's certainly the number that Mark Zuckerberg is going after. And it seems a little, I don't know, almost cynical to me to say that the future of music looks like getting 10 bucks a month from 200 million people.
So I'm going to play... outlier here. I think it's a billion people.
I'm with you. Hang on. I just picked that.
I just want to say, because I didn't say it up there, I think our industry is somewhere going to be, the recorded music industry, between 120 billion and 200 billion in revenue. At its peak was what, John?
34.
So I'm beyond bullish. This guy and I have the exact taste
I'll
of music.
He's
going to freak out later because every artist he bought I represented, and we'll freak out about music. But the slide he put up that said things I worry about, I think are all things that I would never worry about, and I think they're either temporary conditions or what have you. But I believe there would be a minimum of 500 million to a billion paying subscribers, and the rest will listen to Pandora or Pandora-like services. So I do believe that the reason I framed it chapter 14, where we are in our story, and I think John put it very eloquently in his slides, is this is a 20-plus year disruption and rebuild and reconstitution of our industry. But when you see countries, not only like Sweden, you see the adoption, you see people's habits, and I believe that most people don't go backwards in functionality. I think Tom's 100% right, and John is that there's lean-in and lean-back type consumers. That will never change, but once you go to Apple TV, and then you go back to your cable system, you look at that horrible time channel TV guide that no longer makes sense, it kind of is hard to go backwards. I know my children, if you took their Sonos and Spotify away from them at this point, there'd be a mutiny. And I'm not kidding. And I think we're going to grow in hockey stick. And so if we came back here and you invited us back in 3, 5, whatever years, I think we'd have a completely different set of numbers, metrics, monies. And I think the things he said, because you asked about not agreeing, specifically that slide, I think would be done already. Today, I can see it, but I believe they're temporary conditions.
Yeah, so I think there's one more thing I left out, which is really important. Out of that 40 or 50 million, depending on whose numbers you believe for the paid on demand, 3/4 of that is under 20.
Yes.
Okay.
And by the way, years ago, John told me what people were doing on Sonos, and it was more radio, less Pandora, and streaming services were tiny.
Yep.
So when you look at the migration away from terrestrial radio, even through your Sonos, into Pandora and streaming services, which is 75% of the time spent, you're already seeing tectonic shifts in habits. Everybody in this room who has children, I dare you to take however many screens away from your kids and stop them from streaming multiple things at the same time. So I don't think anything's going to go backwards. I think it's going to go forward. The only thing that's going to be different is it might be on your eye or in your ear or implanted in your brain versus in your hand. But, you know, we'll be doing it.
Tom, you're getting beat up here. You want to?
No. I know. This is good for his business, his old business.
Yeah, I would love to see, you know, all of those things, you know, positively addressed over the course of the next 5 years. And I guess I have some optimism that there's room for that to happen.
I think you took a lot of body blows at Pandora.
We did take a lot.
I'm on the outside. You took shots, and it wasn't fair. And when you take shots and you get beat up and you get pummeled, not just by the copyright holders but by the artists, right? You go like your hands are up. You're Muhammad Ali rope-a-doping in the corner, and it influences your thought, right? And it's hard to be positive, 100% positive.
I mean, there's no question that there was a dark hour for me personally. In the conversation with the songwriters, actually, in particular, who kind of came out of nowhere in the you know, fourth quarter of my 10 years at Pandora, disappointed in the way that we shared revenue with them.
You were horribly misunderstood.
And we really were. And at least that was my perspective, you know, sitting on our side of the table. I'm sure there's a reasonable perspective on the other side, too.
They were wrong.
And it was... I mean, it was just exhausting, and it contributed to my decision, like, never fucking again.
Well, look, the good news is you exited with a win. I was the period before you in the .com.
Right.
I got my ass handed to me. Yeah. I lost $60 million and got wiped out in the market crash of 2000.
So
I think it's
60, 80 companies didn't make it, and two or three did. That's an incredible phalanx to get through.
And we were...
I think the Princess Bride actually gets it wrong. I think it's never get into a land war in Asia, never search a digital music company.
Although, you know, you left a company that probably was one of the ones that's going to make it and have scale. So, you know, it's funny to hear you say that when I got killed on the battle. But I get it.
Yeah. Fair enough.
So one of your slides, Marc, talked about who's going to get into whose business. It looks like a feast for the investment bankers. I bring that back.
Not even a question. Yeah. M&A is going to be through the roof.
Yeah, it isn't yet. Like, you talk to the venture capital community, and they've all gotten burned badly, Tom is. So they're pretty gun shy.
But the bankers get commissions. They don't really care about the equity.
Yeah, but there isn't you need a diversity of companies for that, really. So you're going to see two waves. You're going to see this first wave of these guys that didn't make it and made it, and then it opens up, and then when the funding opens up, you'll see 100 ideas.
Right.
You did see songs that get bought already, right?
Yeah, that's
so
true.
They got purchased.
Yeah. But for a song.
They weren't very good. They shouldn't get more.
Well, that was the thing I was about to say. I think part of the challenge is, and there are exceptions here, there's some really great work going on at Spotify, for example, in many deep areas.
Yep.
But there are a lot of services out there that they just weren't that hard to build, and frankly, Google has built a great one themselves and acquired some bits and pieces in, like through Songs. Microsoft has built a great one themselves, you know.
Apple built
one themselves and acquired a company, actually several companies. If you go back a little farther to things like Lala.
Yeah.
So I do think I think Spotify is going to be fine, but I think when we talk about the huge opportunity for M&A, like, really, who's going to buy these companies?
Well,
yeah,
let's
think
just watch. It's all in the future. It's predictive. So let's see, and everybody will.
I mean,
see
every,
in the next few years and see what happens.
I mean, you watch Twitter needs to do something in music. There was that dance around Twitter and SoundCloud, but it was just too early and scary. Facebook's looked at music a bunch. You know, Facebook lives scared of what they did to, who was the?
MySpace.
Yeah, MySpace. A huge amount of traffic on Facebook is music related, yet there's no music related stuff on Facebook. So I think you're going to watch more than you realize.
Let me tell a little story. I got lucky. I got to meet a gentleman named C. Michael Armstrong, who was the CEO of Hughes Electronics, and then he became the CEO of AT&T. And he bought the cable company called TCI, and he was the first guy, and he was not a young guy, and he's a good CEO, who said, one day, and he told this to the AT&T board, we're not going to be a telephone company, we're going to be a cable provider, we're going to be a data provider, we're going to be a mobile phone provider, and we're going to be a home phone provider. And they called them bundled services. And after he bought TCI, I think he spent $70 billion or something on TCI, and said, I've got to have a cable company and the cable offerings. His board basically took him out back and shot him and fired him because they said bundled services aren't going to come anytime soon. Now, I just want to know the last time somebody got solicited by a company that wasn't a bundled service company to get you versed to switch you from whatever, DirecTV got bought by AT&T and now got a blah, blah, blah. So I think the same thing's true. We're at the very early stage where Amazon Prime is really about shipping. It's got a sneaky little content echo thing going on. And Google Play, nobody knows what it is because they are the biggest but the worst marketing company in the entire universe. There's nobody close. So I think if you think about that we're at that level when we still were paying separate cell phone bill, separate home phone, separate cable, separate data to potentially different companies, and today we're getting, you know, 3 months free if you switch to Fios or whatever it is, or Uverse or Verizon Home, blah, blah, blah. We're kind of there in the same time. So when people think about music subscription scaling or anything, everybody has to remember that it may be Netflix that gets you in. It may be Amazon Prime that gets you in. It may be your kid is a video gamer, or you're a TV freak, or you're a movie freak, and that drags in all the other services. So scale in subscriptions can come very fast when that happens. The other thing that we didn't talk about was, I think, John, correct me if I'm wrong, you're better at this. There was a micro-subscription fact released that people are already paying $70, I think, or some amount for online subscriptions when you add all of the different ones included. Your various Netflix, all these things already. Because, you know, one of the things that people are scared of is the $10. I want to rebut that in a minute. By the way, when we all spent, it was about $60 a year on CDs, which it was, you know, whatever study you believe.
Yep.
You weren't getting the whole universe of music, so it's not really a fair fight. And to me, it's ridiculously cheap, but I think that consumers are already paying, and I have two boys. They both watch video. Has anybody watched their kids watch gamers play games online? Okay, so I know this is where the age cutoff really hits, right? That we're like, you're kidding, you're gonna watch over 8 hours some guy playing Call of Duty and it's not even you. So there's a guy that plays Call of Duty professionally online and he has his own subscription service. So you can actually subscribe to him for $5 a month, okay? So you can watch one video gamer play Call of Duty for $5 a month, or you can get the entire universe of music and everything you want, listen to it 24/7 for $10 a month. Now, for your
I have an interesting question about that.
Yeah.
I think, again, to the people who start digital music companies, the idea that the product is all music at $10 a month seems like an incredible gift. It does to me. You're right. I used to spend, you know, I spent hundreds of dollars on records. But, like, you know, but I still got, I had to, like, curate and, like, really think about which are the 40 records I'm going to buy this year because I can't afford more than 40 records. But there is part of me that thinks that that's not like a mainstream consumer itch that needs to be scratched. I think this idea, frankly, that you subscribe to your favorite artist and you give them $5 a month.
That was my company and it failed miserably.
Miserably. It's all about timing. to your point, if someone's going to pay $5 a month to watch this guy play video games, don't you want to pay Trent Reznor $5 a month for whatever?
He doesn't put out as much content as the guy who's playing Call of Duty. Obviously, and it's less.
Maybe not in terms of hours, but in terms of quality, certainly.
And he doesn't say your son's name, which is really why they're paying the $5, right? The point was that I watched kids, if it's a push a button, especially if it's on dad's credit card, spend like a drunken sailor on subscriptions. And I've seen zero resistance. And it's an interesting phenom, but my real point is we're at the early, early point of this, and that when you watch my stepdaughter, who we all grew up with TV that started as free, us old folks, then went to cable. We're paying, you know, our monthly fees for whatever it was, cable and satellite. But now in an Apple TV environment, if you're binge watching, you're now paying per unit. So I'll get bills where she'll watch X and they're paying $2.99, $3.99 an episode, right? And it's infuriating because you're still paying your cable and all the other things. But what I'm watching is somebody who clicks watch and the unit price is outrageous. So four TV shows out is a month of music all you can eat. That's not a close value proposition. Mm-hmm. I don't care what you say, right? Obviously you hate music, it is, but you know, otherwise it's not. And so every sign I'm seeing is that consumers are not freaked out about price. I think the communication, the marketing, the value proposition, YouTube, have been awful, mm-hmm. like legitimately awful. Yep. And I think people like you, I mean, my own artists, David Byrne attacked Pandora and other services. And I had to take him out to lunch and say, you are so wrong. Now he's on the board of Sound Exchange. But it's an interesting, by the way, he's smarter now.
Now the punches are going to fly.
Yeah. But the truth is, I think we're all overreacting early in the game. It's just that the game took a long time to even get here.
Yeah.
That's what I wanted to
talk. Can I just go one more thing, and then I'd like to throw it open a little bit because I see people itching, sitting on their hands. Marc, you also had a slide about the giants and that none of the ones that are there existed 10 years or 20 years ago. And the ones that were there, a lot of them are gone. If you were running Bose, what would you do today?
Buy Sonos. 2 seconds. There's no other thing to do. Not that you could, but yeah. That's what I would do. Yeah. I'd spend all day in Santa Barbara for two reasons. One, it's Santa Barbara, and two, buy Sonos. And there's nothing else they can do. They can compete. But all those companies are kind of done.
Okay.
They have to evolve.
You mean buy Sonos in the sense that Apple bought Next?
Yeah, or bought whatever. You can buy whatever. Yeah, yes, yes. Or Disney bought Pixar.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, sure. Right. Who cares? Right. It's a transformative deal. That's all you can really do.
If you were running Sony, where they won't even license within the same country.
I wouldn't be running Sony. I mean, that's just I don't even know what to tell you. They can't even make a good TV anymore. They're getting killed in every single. If you followed Sony and digital music services, Connect, and all the other things, forget the rootkit. This was a company we all grew up with that was, you know, state-of-the-art technology company. But if you track the things John and I tracked, presumably Tom did too, they made the dumbest mistakes and the worst launches. So I think it's unfixable, frankly. And now the hardware company's broken in addition to the software company. I think the only things that are valued there are the actual content, the music, the studios, the television. That's working. That's content. The rest of it is just throw it out.
Yeah, if that company were in the U.S., it would have been purchased and broken up a while ago and worth a lot more, frankly.
That company would have happened to what happened to Nokia.
So that, in effect,
which is it's gone, right? Nokia's gone. It got bought by Microsoft, God knows why, and then basically shut down.
So on the one hand, we talk about people moving from the box that they're in to a box adjacent or down the line or whatever, but we've got good examples of somebody who's in a bunch of boxes and is totally screwed up and ought to be dismembered. So back to the M&A.
They must have a lot of investment.
They have, they're a vertical company, so they make some of the best sensors for pictures. They do all sorts of things. It's just it's all tangled up with a pictures company, a music company that has no synergy between those.
Right.
You know, the PS4, I think, is beating Xbox right now. So that's probably the most valuable part in Sony. Mm-hmm. But it, you know, the sum is smaller than the sum of the parts.
Right.
I remember that is a company that tried to use the PlayStation as your cable box.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, well, why don't we move to the audience? I see there's some energy out there.
This is a marketing question. What services do boomers use? What services do millennials use? And how do either or both of those compare to what's going on in China?
Oh, boy. What service do boomers use?
I mean, they use Sirius.
Probably Pandora. Sirius
they
and
use,
Pandora?
I mean that's the Sirius product is heavily slanted towards
Boomer.
Towards yeah. boomers, and it's heavily slanted toward talk content and sports content, not music content.
Yeah, but you still, that's 27 million versus 80 million Pandora. Yeah, so yeah. Pandora's got it by users.
I mean, Pandora's largest category by far, though, is millennials, by far. Yeah. Huge, huge. And it's actually funny, in Silicon Valley and down here, you hear a lot of talk about, you know, my kids all listen to Spotify. I think presumably because there's more wealth around and more credit cards that kids have, but like that's not what America looks like. Kids
YouTube.
Listen to Pandora.
Yeah.
And frankly, YouTube. Actually, yeah. I think the funniest thing about every single streaming panel for the last 5 years is we never talk about YouTube, but it is by far the biggest music service in the United States, by far.
Yeah.
Not even close. Like it's bigger than Pandora, it's bigger than Spotify, and we don't even talk about it because you can't get a good number on it, nobody's really getting paid.
Pandora streams more music than YouTube does now in the US.
That's shocking for me to think.
By time spent.
The problem is
time spent, I understand.
The problem is you can't get a US to US number. So you look at the Pandora US number and you look at the YouTube number and it's global, and so they're not comparable.
Right.
Okay, next. Let's go over to traveling mic over there.
Hi.
Signal to the mic carrier so they can.
Yep. This is more of a question for or comment related to Marc about the price point. And obviously, I'm probably biased toward your point of view, too, in that I do pay multiple $10 a month subscriptions, which means I'm not representative of probably anybody other than perhaps you and a couple other folks in this room. But it is a testable hypothesis. So I'm wondering why, and the closest we've probably seen to that in the States was Tidal's initial launch, which tried to justify the $20 a month premium for allegedly higher fidelity. And I don't think that that went too well. And I think the other comparison that perhaps might be a little flawed is when we compare that to our cable services, where most of us don't have a choice. So I don't think any of us are willingly paying these guys $170 a month. We just kind of have to if we want these pipes that we end up streaming all of our music from. So I'm wondering what's going to break that. How is it that we start paying the artists directly that we want, you know, $5 a month? Do the cable companies start segmenting off the music and charging us differently for that? I mean, how does that part play out?
To be clear, my perspective is we've spent arguably the last 10 years testing this, since we've had Rhapsody for well over 10 years. We certainly spent the last 4 or 5 years testing it in the United States with Spotify. And yes, Spotify is getting bigger and bigger and bigger, but they're doing the same thing that iTunes is doing, which is adding new regions every year. And so it's very hard to get that number. Like, no one is happy in the industry with how Spotify has done in the US with respect to converting people to paid. It's way behind every model that they ever put forth for how the service is supposed to grow in the United States. It's not working like Sweden. So we've tested it. It's not working. $10 a month is not. And now I know John's perspective is that they've been lousy at marketing, but my perspective is they were and are the darling of the press, and they've enjoyed in tremendous, you know, word of mouth and goodwill, but they're still tiny in the U.S.
I don't think they've been lousy at marketing. I just don't think they've done any marketing. And it's like
they spent all of their marketing money on the free service, which is supposed to be their marketing program. It's not working.
John and I are very aligned here.
Yeah, I don't agree
Here's what I'd say. When I give talks, I try to explain that if in another world we all transitioned our systems and we bought new dishwashers and washing machines that cleaned our clothes 80% better using liquid detergents, that the suppliers, Procter & Gamble and the other people that made, refused to make liquid and continually try and sell you powder, all right? And it's that rub that it has been not supplier-led. I think on the VMAs that I referenced was the very first ad I saw ever for an artist's new album was available on Spotify, and it was The Weeknd, by the way. It was a client of ours. I think this has been a hugely, and by the way, I call it a poster child for disruption. I think music above all other, more than television, more than movies, even more than books when books went to the Kindle and the iPad, are was massively messed up. And I can, from my perspective, see how beaten up Pandora and other people were, but I think this is a horribly confused message that's been sent to everybody. I think the labels almost said, don't pay for Spotify. And I think Spotify, it's been more in the tech press than people understand. But I know one thing. I give a lot of talks to college students and people under every single one of them listen to SoundCloud, Spotify, and YouTube. Those are the three biggies that they use. Pandora as well for lean back. College students tend to be leaning in, so it's a disproportionate thing. But I think just watch in the next few years, because I think it's about to ramp. And you're right that freemium hasn't worked. And I would say I was charging $2 an artist, $5 an artist, and that people bring it up now, I was doing it. And people say, oh, it's timing. So I think that's really the same answer.
Yeah, and Tom, I mean, I know what the initial goals for Spotify were in the US, and they were with no marketing. Okay, so let's say it was 50 million in the first year, and that wasn't far off. You're just not gonna get a change of behavior. You're not gonna get people to open their wallets, put a credit card in to be charged $10 a month, and not do any marketing.
But they spent heavily on marketing in the form of the free
service. No, no, no.
They pay for all those tracks.
You're calling that marketing.
That's literally their marketing program.
I understand. They call it marketing.
Okay, let me break it up.
I get it. You can agree on that one.
Melissa's got a question in a different direction here.
Yeah.
Was there a question anyway?
It's coming, yeah. Let's hope so.
So you guys talked about a number of the services we have today, kind of disruption, and that the artists are now able to promote themselves, or there may be avenues for that. But what other types of disruptors do you see coming down the pipe? You guys are forward-thinking individuals, and where do you see things perhaps going, except either cavitating or taking off?
Well, I think you're already ahead of the curve a little bit, because the artists are figuring out how to market themselves. So you have the people like Taylor Swift, who is just multi-dimensionally skilled, and she uniquely has a skill set and can make the, you know, decision she makes and takes advantage of it. But most artists don't have that skill set. You go to the two guys from the UK, the Ruin Brothers. They're artists, and that's when the Marcs come in. And the whole ecosystem is having to learn. Tom talked about the artist management portal at Pandora, where an artist can come in and look at where their tracks are played. I've talked to all the labels. That one guy he referenced, Daniel Glass, is the one that uses that.
He's the only smart one out there, so it doesn't
And so they're not instrumented to use the tools that are out there yet. They're starting to get that in as the Pandoras and the Spotify has a huge program to show the labels and the artists where the tracks are played and how often they're played. And frankly, it's for marketing purposes, it's a far better tool, because what they had to used to listen to is huge extrapolations from
anecdotal.
Yeah, anecdotal. So there's a lot of really good stuff happening. It's just complete change.
Yeah, let me speak to it for 1 second. This is it's even broader than that. In my era, there was one channel. There was no Spotify. There was the artist's official website, and that's really how it started in the early 90s-ish, mid-90s. And the artist had to learn, artist manager, whatever. Before that, they'd lean on their record label, their publicist, and they'd do the work for them, and they'd show up, maybe do an interview or what have you. They'd make video, they'd go on tour. The website came, they had to email out the fans. Our company would do that for them and try to teach them how to do it. They'd have to post updated information on their website. Fast forward, artists are not desktop publishers. They're not newspaper publishers. They're not daily publishers. They don't understand how to do that. Fast forward to where we are today with Instagram, Snapchat, Facebook, YouTube. Forget Spotify and Pandora. Those are music services. Most of the marketing happens on Facebook and Instagram and YouTube and those other broader faces. So now an artist has 20 meaningful channels to program, and they all have a different rhythm of what content goes, what type of content, what day, what hour, when it should be published, and then you respond to your fans and what have you. So all of a sudden, you've got to be a major publisher and an artist, and it, And you have to be authentic, so you can't give it to your record label or the marketers that used to do it, because if it's not you, it's not authentic, and they can't, they'll, it's not Taylor Swift, it's a superpower, yeah. You gotta take her out of this. So artists are really challenged with learning this stuff. And not only that, we did a count internally with our clients, a massive agency, 2,400 music artists. Their combined reach is 2.6 billion people, all right? So it's pretty wide reach. If you look at Forbes or any metric, the music artist, because remember, Facebook, Instagram, it's the same platform, whether you're a film star, whether you're a TV star, whether you're an author, whether you're a video game star, whether you're a music star. So it's the first time you can see everything on the same plane, same device, same service. And the music artists have the biggest social networks, and they're the highest earners, by far, front of sports as well. So you have a responsibility, you know, when you're Rihanna or Lady Gaga is a client, and they have 55, you know, million fans on Instagram and 70 million fans on YouTube, and you're not putting out content for a couple hours, and people start screaming at you. You're like, whoa, what do I do here? So I think it's a massive shift where artists today have to forget their mystique, they have to be authentic in real time with their consumers, and they have to be able to program multiple channels, and the frequency of content they have to go put out is up 20, 50x. So it's a massive shift in addition to learning how to read Spotify and Pandora metrics. Mm-hmm. So that's the answer I give.
So that's a huge...
So it's just start, it's, I mean, it's just trickling in, just the beginning.
I'll just to provide one other sort of disruptive thing that I think is coming. I think we've made a lot of progress in the last 10 years with respect to personalize the music listening experience around a single person. So, you know, as I talked about, like, pretty terrible, like, kind of playlisting experience on Pandora in 2004, getting pretty good in 2015. But it's still really just about you. And, I mean, one of the great things about music, what makes it social, is that we experience it together. It's on Sonos in our home, it's in the car with our family, it's at, in a bar, and, you know, in your place where you get your haircut. And I think one of the really interesting things that's starting to happen is all these great minds that have been focused on how do we personalize a single stream are starting to think about how do we personalize for the group of people that are in the room, and how do we dynamically change that as people come in and out. I mean, part of what I think is going to continue to evolve here is it's just going to become simpler and simpler and simpler to interact with this vast world of music around us. Like, the notion that you have to make playlists is already becoming ridiculous. Yeah. The notion that you have to rip CDs or manage MP3s is becoming yesterday's thinking. Like, it's all going to get easier. And ultimately, I mean, the goal here is, you know, the machines read your mind and play exactly the right music for you. And I think more than you would guess, that's within our grasp.
Okay, one last question. And, okay, over there, I'm sorry, okay.
Yeah, I'm thinking, this is probably for Marc more than anybody, I think that article from David Byrne that I read before I came was probably your suggestion. What is the state of transparency? You know, that was sort of part of that article, and where is that going in the near future in terms of artists can see how much money's coming in, the labels, all that sort of stuff?
There's some companies out there, like Cobalt being one of them, that are starting to build what I call, you know, the e-tradization, flattening of revenue that I talked about. They're starting to build tools, and artists are starting to allow them to both upload their music and be their collection services. CSAC got purchased by an investment banker who also bought Harry Fox agency, and he's trying to turn it into a transparent, real-time, honest log file processing.
That's what Tidal was promising too,
yeah,
right?
I think it's like a lot of other things. You know, John said something that's really true. We live in a Google world, but I grew up in a Lycos, InfoSeek world. And I'm not sure that a lot of the brands in that world are gonna make it. They were old school, started 80, 100 years ago, performing rights organizations that collect monies a certain way. And I think they're gonna go the way of the dodo birds. And it's gonna take a while. It's probably a 5 to 10 year re-engineering process, but I think we're going to, because remember, the movie producers want this, and the actors, the TV studios want this, the authors want this. Everybody who is paid at the end of the digital transaction wants a clean, transparent, they know what was sold, they know who the user is, and they can market to them and talk to them, and they see the when the things hit, when it's downloaded on Netflix or hit play on Netflix, they want it in their account X minutes later, and it's all possible from an engineering standpoint. So I think we're on the 5 to 10 year track. It's not just gonna be music. As I said earlier, film has had one of the most famous messed up accounting systems ever.
It's already happened for books. It just took a monopoly player in the Amazon, but
right.
That successfully made the transition to digital without disrupting the whole ecosystem.
Yeah, and that we have a huge author division. They were squealing. It was tough. But it's going to happen. It's just a question of time, is the answer.
You're welcome to stay and crowd around and keep them here all night if you can. I really do want to thank all three of you for a terrific evening.